This is Dr. Max Shouts, pastor of the Heritage Baptist Bible Church in Walnut Grove, Minnesota. It is our privilege to be with you now for this half hour, and we hope that you have your Bibles out and you're ready to follow along, because that's the only way that we learn the Word of God is to give it out and you take it in. We'll be back in just a moment. Thank you. It is so good to have you join with us the same time each week. And again, we count it our real privilege to be able to join with you and to come into your homes and to bring our Bible lesson here each time this week. And it's our real privilege. And again, we thank you so much for joining with us and inviting your friends to listen to the broadcast. At times, we get a letter from someone who said so-and-so said that they enjoyed your broadcast, and we've tuned into it and just wanted to write you and let you know how much it means to us. So we appreciate that very, very much. Now, we're continuing on our Bible study here, as we have in the past few weeks, about various religions that claim they believe in God or a God, and can you believe in God and go to hell? Well, of course, you most assuredly can, unless you believe what God says to believe. For example, now, for you that are listening, do you believe the God of the Bible? Do you believe that God created the heavens and the earth? Do you believe that God created mankind? And you may answer, yes, I sure do. All right, let's continue on a little bit and see if you believe what else God says to believe. God says in Romans chapter 3, verse 23, that we have all sinned and come short of the glory of God. That is the absolute perfection and righteousness of God. No human being can say that they are absolutely perfect and sinless, yet God can, you see. So do you agree with that, that you are a sinner? And not saying that you're better than someone else, you may be, but you're still a sinner. And do you believe Romans chapter 6, verse 23? And the Bible says that the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. So, God says that eternal life is a free gift. And I've had from time to time, but it's not been very often, but a few times, I've heard someone say when I've witnessed to them or quoted a verse to them or told them that eternal life is a free gift, well, I don't want to take it. I'm not going to take anything that's free. After all, I'm either going to pay for it or I'm not going to take it. And, boy, you just see the pride swell up in them, you know. Anyway, God will never give you eternal life for something you do. No matter how good it is, you will never merit eternal life. You see, to go to heaven, you must be perfect. And, therefore, that excludes all mankind because all have sinned in Romans 3:23 and come short of the absolute perfection of God, the sinlessness of God. So, God says in John chapter 3 and verse 16, he says, I'll tell you what I'll do. I'll pay for your sins so you don't have to go to hell and do it yourself. And God said, I love the world and I gave my only begotten Son, that's Jesus Christ, that whosoever believeth in him would never perish but have everlasting life. So you either believe that God paid for your sin when he sent Jesus Christ from heaven to earth, come down here, die on the cross, pay for your sins, resurrected, and ascended back to heaven because his work was done. He paid for the sins of the world. Will you believe that? Will you trust that? Will you rely upon it with no reservations whatsoever because the Word of God declares it? Then if you do and are trusting Christ and him alone, not your baptism, your confirmation, or your good works, or anything else that you can do out of the flesh, then God says you'll never perish but have everlasting life. So, we're going to continue now, enough for that right now, but we're going to continue with that little background there and show you concerning Islam, the message of Muhammad. Now, in this, we have the Muslims and their religion. You hear a lot about them in the news today and all the terrorists and everything, and then you'll hear some people say, well, you know, they're not all terrorists, and it's really a peaceful religion. Well, we're going to see if that's true or if that's what Satan wants you to believe. And we're going to take this from the Quran itself and from its writings, which is their Bible, just as the Bible is the Word of God to us from the Word of God, you see. Now, as we begin, we find out that they are required and they worship a God called Allah. There is no God but Allah, and Muhammad is the prophet of Allah, is the great Shahada. And they say the great Shahada means, or confession, which faithful Muslims around the world declare every day. Now, this declaration of faith effectively distinguishes Muslims from every other religion, including Christianity, Judaism, and many Muslims and people, millions of Muslims and people worldwide claim Allah as their God and Muhammad as their prophet, you see. Millions of people embrace the Islamic faith. Entire countries are ruled and dominated by Islamic teachings and practices and their laws. Much of the Western world is dependent upon Islamic nations for a major portion, a major portion of their petroleum, their oil, and so forth. Western towns, universities, and businesses are seeing a larger influx of Muslims than has ever been seen before. Islam is a religious, it's a social, and it's also a political force which every American should be aware of. It is vastly growing. There are more Muslims in America than ever have been. I wonder what the reason for that is. We're going to see, because we hear things put out that, it's just a peaceful religion. It's just these terrorists and so forth that are the ones causing all the trouble. But we're not like that. Now, I'm going to project this now, and I'm also going to keep projecting it as we go through studying a little bit of information here about the Muslim religion and what the Quran, in the Quran, for example, over 100 places, it tells them to fight and to destroy anyone who is not a Muslim. Over 100 places in the Quran. The sad part is very few people even in America have any idea of what the Quran says or even have a copy of the Quran or have never read the Quran, you see. So, they just have what's been told to them, oh, these are peaceful people, and so on and so forth. So, we're going to see that as we go on, and we're going to take right from the Quran itself, this is their Bible, folks. This is their Bible. This, if they are a Muslim, this is what they believe. Now, I'm going to make a statement I started to make just a few seconds ago, and that is my question, which you never hear proposed concerning Muslims and the Quran. You just hear, well, these are peaceful people, but just the extremists are the ones causing all the terrorism and so forth. I take objection to that. And here's something I'll bet you've never heard. I haven't heard it, and I wonder why I haven't heard it. I wonder why leaders have not brought it out. But this is something that I think should be brought out, at least if you're thinking, you know. If you tell me that you are a Muslim and you're a peaceful Muslim, then my question to you is, why are you a Muslim? Because you don't believe your own Bible. Because out of over these 100 places in the Quran tells you to kill people and to get rid of them. And the whole philosophy, as we're going to see, and we're going to quote places from the Quran which substantiate this, and that is that their goal under Allah and Muhammad, their prophet, as stated in the Quran, that their goal is to convert the whole world to the Islamic faith and to worship of Allah. Now, I question any Muslim, if you're a Muslim and you're of the Islamic faith and the Quran is your Bible, then why are you a Muslim if you're telling me you don't believe in violence? Then you really don't believe the Quran. And if you don't believe the Quran, why are you a Muslim? That question, I can't remember ever hearing this, even in the time now. Why are they not pinned down to do that? We had a doctor who was a Muslim. And he was my doctor for a while until he moved and went to Dallas, Texas. He was a very nice man. And I witnessed to him that Jesus Christ is the only way to heaven. And he objected to that Allah was his God, and so forth. And I said, well, you hate me then, don't you? And this is back in the room where the doctor and the patient are there, you know. And I said, well, you hate me then, really, don't you? Oh, no, I don't. No, I don't. I said, you're supposed to, because I'm not going to convert to an Allah who is God that was made up by a self-made prophet by the name of Mohammed. And I said, there is no Allah at all. Now, you have a God, but it's not the God of the Bible. It's not the God of creation. But a man made this up and said that Allah, through his messenger, had revealed this in a dream to Muhammad, and we'll get to a little more specific on that in a few minutes here, and give him these revelations and so forth, just like a David Koresh or a Jim Jones from Guyana, South Africa, and so forth, and all of these tutti-frutties, I call them quackos, running around saying, you know, I'm of Christ, or I am Jesus Christ. We had one here not long ago stating, I am Jesus Christ, you know, and these things. So Muhammad made up all of these writings and so forth that are in the Quran and put them there and so forth. And I said, you know, what did you worship? What would you worship before this? And there were other gods that they worshipped. They had even female deities and so on and so forth. But I said, no, there is no Allah. There is no God here of creation. Muhammad made this up. He wrote this on palm leaves. He wrote it on anything he could find to write on. And later they were put into a collection, and now you have the Quran. But anyway, to make a long story short, it's very nice. And I said, well, I don't believe that and so forth. And I said, well, and I quoted him some things. I couldn't remember what the verses were in the Quran exactly. There's many, many, many of those. But anyway, I quoted him things from the Quran, and he just couldn't believe it. And I said, well, you don't know your own so-called Bible then. But anyway, I invited him down. I said, let's have a cookout where we can get out of being in a business attire here at the clinic and so forth, and bring your family. And come on down, and we'll fry some hamburgers or steaks or something, and we can sit down and talk. And he agreed to that. And he was going to give me a time. And anyway, a couple of weeks went by, or 3 weeks, something like that. anyway, I come to find out that he had, I think, taken another position down in Dallas, Texas. So that never manifested itself for that. But the only thing I know is he knew that I knew that Jesus Christ, and I remember one thing I had told to him, related to him. I said, if Allah is God, why didn't they date the time from Allah? And I said, Jesus Christ and Muhammad is dead, but my Savior's still alive. And anyway, I said, our whole time's dated from Jesus Christ here, and I give our time here, you know, and I said, that's A.D. That's after death. That's Anno Domini in Latin, the year of our Lord. And so forth. But anyway, I couldn't convince him, but anyway, he agreed to come down, and I thought that was really nice, but it never did manifest itself. But anyway, let's go on here to get some information about this and the Quran and so forth. They say there is no God but Allah. Muhammad is the prophet of Allah, and the great Shahada, or confession, and Muslims, as we've said, all over the world declare this every day, you see. Millions, as we've said, and this is maybe a little surprise to people in America. They don't realize how many millions and millions of people that embrace the Islamic faith. Entire countries are ruled and dominated by their teachings and their practices and so forth like that, you see. Islam, like many religions, it has its own vocabulary to describe its beliefs. If we take a quick look at some of the most important religious terms in Islam, it'll provide a basis for further discussion of the Islamic history and the belief and so forth. It may help you to understand a little bit. Maybe you know this, and maybe some don't. Islam, it is the name of the religion which came out of the revelations and the teachings of Muhammad. Islam is the Arabic term for submission. And you want to remember that, because that is what the whole Quran is about, submitting to their made-up God. Now, Muslim is the name given to one who adheres to the religion of Islam. Muslim is an Arabic cognate of Islam, which means one who submits. The Muslim submits to the will of Allah as revealed by Muhammad. Allah is the Islamic name for God, and cannot really be translated easily into English. One Muslim writer defined it as this: the word means the unique God who possesses all the attributes of perfection and beauty in their infinitude. Muslims feel strongly that the English word God does not convey the real meaning of the word Allah. Now we come to Muhammad. Muhammad was the common name of an Arabic man born in the city of Mecca in A.D. about 570. He claimed that he was the prophet to restore true religion and the praise of Allah throughout the world, just as Jesus Christ was a prophet in his time for his people. Muhammad means the one who is praised. Now, we come to the Quran. Now, it's spelled in different ways. One way is spelled Q-U-R-A-N, another way is spelled K-O-R-A-N, and it is Arabic for the recitation and refers to the collection of revelations supposedly given by Allah through his archangel to Muhammad, and then preserved as the Islamic scripture, just as the Bible is preserved for the Christians as the scriptures that come from God, which they were. Now, we come on down and find out that the Bible used by Christians and Jews is a distorted version of those scriptures. Now, this is what's held to by the Muslims. Wherever the Bible contradicts Islam, the Muslim says the Bible is incorrect. Surah, now we come to that word. Surah refers to the divisions within the Quran. Now, I have two Qurans, and in the Qurans you'll find out that both of them give from the translation from the Arabic into the English, but it's not real easy to translate that, you see. And one Quran will state essentially what the other Quran says, but not in exactly the same English words. So you'll find that they accept whatever it is. If it says Quran, they accept it, even though it may be stated a little bit differently. So when we give some of these scriptures, you may have a different translation of the Quran, and it may not read exactly as if you want to check it up as the scriptures we give you out of the Quran. But anyway, let's go back here now to Surah. Now, you'll find in the Quran, you'll find Surah all through, and Surah refers to the divisions within the Quran, and it roughly corresponds to our chapter. So if we say Surah 9:14, that would be chapter 9:14, because all of the divisions are called Surah when you read it, you see. The Quran contains 114 revelations, each composing one Surah or chapter, you see. The shortest revelations appear first, the longest ones last. There is no chronological arrangement in the Quran. Also, I think it's important, is the Islamic literature is the Hadith, or Arabic for the collection of traditions, or collected traditions. These customs provide source material for the intricate political and social structure of Islam. Now, the Khalifa is Arabic for leader, and it refers to the main leaders of Islam, especially the immediate successors of Muhammad. We've all heard of Ayatollah. Ayatollah refers to a spiritual master or leader in Islam, of whoever it may be, you see. Now, we come and we find out that of the millions of Muslims worldwide, by far the greatest number are members of the Sunnite sect. They accept the four caliphs in direct succession from Muhammad and no others. The second largest sect of Islam is the Shiite sect. Approximately 93% of Iran's Muslims are Shiites, led by the most powerful Shiite Ayatollah Khomeini. Now, we come here and we find out what are some of their beliefs. Well, often people claim that the Muslims believe in the same God as Christians. Well, there couldn't be anything further from the truth. They just don't accept Jesus Christ. Well, if they don't accept Jesus Christ, then they don't believe in the same God as Christians do, you see. But, however, as we're going to see, the Muslim God is not like the Christian God. Islam rejects the biblical doctrines of the Trinity and also the deity of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, for the Muslim, Allah is the only true God. There's no such blasphemous thing as we call the Trinity. In other words, Jesus Christ is a prophet of Allah. He is not the Son of God or God himself. And that's found in Surah. Now remember what we said that Surah was? Is the head of the chapter. And it's chapter 4 in verse 171. Now, if you have the same translation I have, it'd be on page 78. but if you don't have the same translation I have here of the Quran, then you have to hunt the page for yourself. The Muslim God is unapproachable by sinful man. He is so perfect and holy, he can only communicate with mankind through a progression of angels and prophets. The Muslim God is a God of judgment, not a grace. A God of wrath, rather than love. The Muslim's desire is to submit to the point where he can hold back the judging arm of Allah, and maybe perhaps through the winning, the approval of Allah, inherit eternal life in an earthly paradise of gluttony and sexual gratification. Muslims have no concept of God as a loving and compassionate Father. Now, what about Jesus Christ? As we've mentioned above, Jesus Christ to the Muslim is just one of many prophets of Allah. Jesus Christ was a prophet for his people in his day. The prophet Muhammad supersedes Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is not the Son of God or a part of any Trinity. Jesus Christ did not atone for anyone's sins, although he was himself sinless. Jesus Christ did not die on the cross. And you see, various Muslim traditions say that he either miraculously substituted Judas Iscariot for himself on the cross, or that God miraculously delivered him from the hands of the Romans and Jews before he could be crucified, you see. Most Muslims believe that Jesus Christ was taken bodily into heaven without having died. And that's found in Surah, that is, chapter 4, in verse 157, you see. So, we find out also that sin and salvation in Islam is associated with two concepts, works and fate. Every Muslim who hopes to escape the judgment of Allah must fulfill the works of the five pillars of faith. And as found in Surah, what is Surah again? That's the chapter 10, verse 109. And these include the recitation of the Shahada, and that is, they have to recite this, there is no God but Allah, and Muhammad is the prophet of Allah. Number two, five daily prescribed prayers in Arabic. And these prayers include that they face the city, the holy city of Mecca, and so forth. Number three, almsgiving, which is unlike tithing, since Muslims are only required to give 1/40 of their income as charitable contributions. Then number four is fasting. Fasting, and that is during the entire month of Ramadan. Now, you've heard a lot of that, haven't you? The holy month of Ramadan and so forth. And that's when Muslims are supposed to fast from all food and drink from sunrise to sunset in atonement for their own sins over the previous year. However, after sunset, many of the Muslims enjoy a feast, and some get up before sunrise to eat some more before the sun rises and fast begins again. And number five, a pilgrimage, that is to Mecca, the holy city at least once in a Muslim's lifetime. Then we have something that you're hearing a little bit about on the news, and that is the holy war, the jihad. The jihad is a holy war, and we're going to get some information from the Quran, their own writings, or the writings, I should say, that Muhammad made up and put in there as from God. But anyway, it's used, and the Muslims are to have this holy war, and as we're going to read many scriptures from the Quran, that this holy war is to be a war against anyone who will not submit to the Islamic faith and worship Allah. Their goal is to have a worldwide religion with the world worshiping Allah, and if you do not want to submit to that, then you are to be killed. Doesn't sound much like a peaceful religion, does it? Too much. Anyway, so I see our time has sort of slipped away here. We wanted to bring you some other things here as introduction type here. But anyway, we'll pick that up next week and continue on with it there. But the most important thing is, and we're going to get some quotes here from people, and about the fact that, oh, the Muslim religion is a peaceful religion. President Bush brought this out, and I respect the office of the presidency, and I respect the president, but in this respect, when he made a statement like that, he was entirely off base, and he was entirely wrong. He should have checked with some religious leaders, or at least read the Quran, and he would have never made such a statement. But sometimes to make political statements just to appease people and to pat somebody on the back just in order to say that, well, you believe their religion is peaceful, is literally suicide, because the Muslims know better than that. And they know if you say they have a peaceful religion that they have totally outsmarted you and fooled you, and you become one of their victims. But that's their goal, is to have a one-world religious system with everyone worshiping Allah. And if you don't do that, then you are to die, you see. And we're going to see that in the Quran. So it's going to be a difference from what you hear all of the liberal media put out and Time Magazine and others that put out and trying to brainwash you that this is just peaceful. It is nowhere close to being peaceful, folks. This is one of the most devastating religions, and we are infiltrated in America with millions of Muslims, and this is not good at all. So, in closing, let me just say this. Have you trusted Jesus Christ as your Savior? I hope that you have, because you might believe in the God of the Bible, you might believe God created you, you might believe God created the world and all the universe and everything else, but have you trusted Jesus Christ, God's payment for your sin? If you have not done that, then you're not saved, you see. But if you're saved, that means you're saved from hell, and you are putting your faith, or have put your faith, in Jesus Christ. God loved the world and gave his only begotten Son. You believe he died on the cross, he was buried, he rose again, and he paid for your sins personally. And by believing that with no reservations, God says, I'll make you two promises. Number one, you'll never perish but have everlasting life. And I see our time's gone. If you've trusted Christ by listening to the broadcast, we'd appreciate you writing us. Just let us know. And we'd just be so thrilled to share that with you. We really would. We'd invite you to go to our website. It's www.heritagebbc.org. And don't put all one. I mean, that's all one word. HeritageBBC.com. And click on there, and you'll find hundreds of Bible questions people have asked, and we've attempted to try to answer those. I think you'll enjoy that. And also, we appreciate your writing. And we hope you'll take time to write. Our mailing address is the Heritage Radio Bible Class, Post Office Box 573, Walnut Grove, Minnesota, and our zip code is 56180. Until next week at the same time, keep looking up, because Jesus is coming.